गुड इवनिंग मैम.
हाँ, गुड इवनिंग. टेल मी मैम.
टुडे आई विल बी प्रेजेंटिंग अ न्यूरोलॉजी केस. माय पेशेंट इज अ 32 ईयर ओल्ड मेल पेशेंट हु इज फ्रॉम ओरिसा. हिज ऑक्यूपेशन इज आईटी प्रोफेशनल. ही वाज एग्जामिन्ड ऑन 9th ऑफ दिस मंथ. ही इज अ राइट हैंडेड पर्सन. इन्फॉर्मेंट इज सेल्फ एंड फादर. कमिंग टू द चीफ कंप्लेंट्स, patient had history of difficulty in speech since 1 year, difficulty in swallowing since 1 year, stiffness in all four limbs since 11 months, involuntary twitching in both upper limbs since 9 months. Coming to history of presenting complaints, patient was apparently well 1 year ago when he noticed difficulty in speech, insidious in onset, gradually progressive in the form, difficulty to pronounce names and words clearly, with missing of syllables and nasal intonation while speaking. This was associated with swallowing difficulty to solids and liquids, nasal regurgitation of liquids, and has to cough out sputum regularly. There was no difficulty while chewing food.
Missing of syllables means what, ma'am? So he had a speech problem, which is slowly progressive, okay, but pronounce names. That means what was happening when he is speaking names? It's not a language, no, because when you use the term pronounce names,
yes, ma'am,
missing of syllables, then it looks like a Broca's aphasia, naming defect, and as well as missing syllables. So you miss something and you put a telegraphic speech. So what you should be telling, well, it's not names, no, is it only for nouns? Others were all right, huh?
No, it was for everything.
So you should not use this, because then you are confusing it with the language. When you say names, no?
Yes,
it will indicate that it is a nominal aphasia.
Correct.
You understand? So
yes,
clearly it is not an aphasia. So you should not use the term names. Patient has difficulty in pronouncing words. And what kind of words it was? That depends on the type of dysarthria. But if you say pronouncing names and missing of syllables, then it looks like a non-fluent nominal aphasia, which is very typical of Broca's aphasia, which is clearly it is not from the way the disease is progressing. No.
Yes, ma'am.
So you will modify this sentence and say that my patient has got a speaking difficulty with the proper comprehension, proper ability to write, proper ability to read. Only the spoken part of the communication is affected, and it was affected in the following way. One is very clearly nasal intonation. That means pharyngeal phase. So nasal intonation means pharyngeal phase. So palatal muscles are affected. Next, what was the other one? Was it only the palatal phase or you know that we classify dysarthria into, if you say pronounced names and missing syllables, you will call it as a Broca's aphasia.
Yes.
Incomplete Broca's aphasia, which it is clearly not. So we will tell nasal tongue is very clear. So you think about other type of speech. You have to clarify into that. You have got a spastic dysarthria. We have got flaccid dysarthria. We have got a dyskinetic dysarthria. You have got cerebral dysarthria. And you have got dysarthria due to flaccid dysarthria. So spastic dysarthria means patient will have increased effort. He will squeeze words into one another and he'll be straining to bring out. If there is spasticity, bipyramidal signs, he can have spastic. Then you will find that it is not missing of syllables, but syllables running into one another. We call it as speaking with hard potato in the mouth. So syllables will not have their normal space. So is it there? Is he putting lot of effort and squeezing words? That is spastic. Flaccid, if it is the tongue, that will be specific, not like names or syllables. It will be for words containing linguals. Linguals are L, D, T. So if the person is otherwise all right, but when he is speaking the linguals, L, D and T, his speech is altered. That you have to specifically look, patients won't know. No? Then it is a lingual type of flaccid dysarthria. Labial type, if the lip is orbicularis oris is affected, patient will have difficulty in pronouncing words containing P and B. And if it is due to loss of teeth, then it will be D and T. If it is due to palatals, it will be NG, GG. So definitely you have got a flaccid element with reference to the nasal intonation. NGGG, that's a nasal tone. Singing, bringing. So you told nasal element. So probably there is a palatal flaccid dysarthria of pharyngeal type. But whether what are the other things, you have to get proper information. Then you will know. We are expecting that it may be lingual and it may be labial. Lingual means L, D, T. Labial means P, B. So you have to ask, grammar will be all right. Word output will be all right. Meaning will be all right. But the way he pronounced some words is altered. That's what you should be telling. And on examination, I found that these words which contain L, D, T, P, B are affected. So it's a flaccid dysarthria involving labials, linguals and gutturals. NGGG is a guttural. Guttural is very clear. You have told nasal tongue. So gutturals are affected. In addition, what is affected is not language. So word handling is very important. So you should be telling, if you say names, we will think it's only nouns. Then it becomes nominal aphasia. Missing means telegraphic. You understand?
Yes,
so it is definitely not there. So you have to say, my patient has got some problem, but he's fluent, he's able to comprehend, he's able to read, he's able to write. But he has a problem other than nasal tongue also, that I will characterize when I examine. Like that you can tell. Patient himself is will not be able to tell. He will not tell D, T, L, P, B, you will not be able to tell. So you will look for that. Nasal tongue, all patients will tell. So probably it's a flaccid dysarthria. Gutturals is very clear. What others is involved, you will examine and see. And this is associated swallowing difficulty to solids and liquids with nasal regurgitation. That supports the diagnosis of gutturals. No? When yes, the gutturals, the pharyngeal muscles are involved, solids and liquids will be difficult. We say that if it is upper motor neuron, liquids need quick coordination. Very quick, very fine coordination is needed for liquids. So in upper motor neuron, because kinetic melody is lost, liquids are lost early and then solids also. Solids need powerful coordination. So in lower motor neuron, solids are more difficult because power loss. Upper motor neuron, it is movement loss. So this person is having bipyramidal and all, you told, spastic limbs. So in that case, if it is due to upper motor neuron, liquids need quick coordination with fine kinetic melody. So solids need powerful. So in this patient, both are affected. That might indicate advanced involvement of either LMN or MN. So after a period of time, both will be lost in neurogenic and it is the pharyngeal phase. So swallowing, I have told, you should tell about the oral phase. You have told chewing is all right. So oral phase, pharyngeal phase, esophageal phase, you have to tell. Oral phase is all right. It's a pharyngeal phase. And the speech is also pharyngeal phase. So that qualifies for the palatal involvement. Is it bulbar or pseudobulbar is the question. Both bulbar and pseudobulbar will produce nasal speech. So that doesn't help you to differentiate whether it is upper motor neuron type of pseudobulbar pharyngeal involvement that can produce nasal tongue. And swallowing also can happen. If you are able to distinguish as liquids are first affected and that was the spilling all the time, later, then you can say it is upper motor neuron to start with and then it went on to lower motor neuron also, or the upper motor neuron itself progressed, or it can be either way. So in LMN and UMN at one point, powerful coordination and quick coordination will. This is not mechanical obstruction because your patient is having regurgitation. In mechanical obstruction, what gets affected is the esophageal phase. And they will not have nasal regurgitation. Instead, they have to use some fluids or something and push the food out. So both qualifies for a pharyngeal phase of swallowing and pharyngeal phase of speech involvement. Most probably it is LMN, but it can be UMN. We do not know.
Yes, ma'am.
Next symptom. So he has speaking and swallowing difficulty. This was followed by when he noticed he was speaking, trying to. 1 month later, he developed stiffness in the right upper limb. Insidious in our slur. Stiffness was manifested as what? Was it just a feeling of stiffness or hypostonia? Or did he have difficulty in holding pen, difficulty in writing, Was it also there or only the increase in the tone?
Yes, ma'am. First, we noticed the stiffness in right upper limb, ma'am.
So stiffness means he noticed hypertonia.
Yes, ma'am.
In what areas he appreciated that?
First, he noticed while
whole trying.
No, ma'am. First, he noticed while trying to spray liquid with his right hand and while working on computer keyboard.
So it was distal.
Yes, ma'am.
So he noticed stiffness during fine movement.
Yes, ma'am.
Stiffness is never LMN.
Yes,
ma'am. So stiffness is UMN, and UMN always involves fine movement. So using computer keyboard, you use alternate typing. So it is again, it is kinetic melody. So you have to flex one finger, extend another finger, and it was stiff. So definitely it is an upper motor neuron involvement. What got affected is the rhythm of the activity. So computer keyboard or piano or veena, we tell that alternatively we use. That will be lost. Instead, they may be able to do it with one finger. That is typical of upper motor neuron. If it is lower motor neuron, it will be flail. They will drop the pen. They will not be able to press. They might find the thinness of the muscles. So here what you are telling, there is no thinness. They were not, he was not dropping. He was able to press, but he had difficulty and stiffness. You can ask him whether he had more easily he could do with one finger. Was it the rhythm that was lost? That question, if you have asked, that will be more useful clinically to know whether in the lower, in the upper limb, is it LMN plus UMN or only UMN?
Yes, ma'am.
Stiffness is UMN. Keyboard operation is UMN. You can ask whether he could grip. Was he having flailness or was he having problem in alternate pressing? Individual finger pressing was possible. Alternate pressing is not possible, means it is UMN. Neither individual finger nor alternate is possible. And the limb was flail, means LMN. So apparently he has got a bulbar involvement, which looks like LMN, because pseudobulbar features, emotional ability, all those things you did not mention, and both solids and liquids got affected, and so probably it's LMN. And in the upper limb, there is definite involvement of UMN, corticospinal tract. Next, what happened?
He then noticed increasing difficulty to mix his food. Yes, ma'am. And make a bowl.
Mixing food is by what muscles, ma'am?
Lumbricals, ma'am. Small muscles.
Yes, so lumbricals became affected. Initially, it is upper motor. Then he is developing problem with the using of lumbricals. And making a bolus is by long flexors. So in lumbricals and long flexors became affected. And buttoning is by opponents. So it looks like lumbricals, forearm flexors, and opponents got involved. Okay, then what happened now?
However, the patient can guide the bolus to the mouth without difficulty and does not spill the food.
Okay, so you did not have any incoordination. Okay.
Yes. There was no history of difficulty in reaching overhead objects or combing hair.
So proximal part is all right. Then what happened?
The patient can appreciate the
sensations are all right.
Yes, okay. Ma'am.
Why sensation should be asked in a case like this, ma'am? This patient's problem started with bulbar symptom, and he's a relatively young person, and he has got one upper limb stiffness with probably LMN involvement distally. So you rightly asked about the sensation. What is the importance? Very good. You asked that history, very relevant. Young person. Why did you ask this, ma'am? You should know about syringomyelia. You see,
yes.
Syringomyelia and syringobulbia will involve bulbar muscles and stiffness with LMN features and dissociated anesthesia. So he's a young person. You should not forget syringomyelia and syringobulbia. So very good that you asked about hot, cold, and other sensation. In this child, if he has started with bulbar features and then develop stiffness of one upper limb, craniovertebral junction anomaly, and syringomyelia, syringobulbia is a very important differential diagnosis. So it's very, very good that you asked about sensations as the symptom is evolving. Very good. So because very important diagnosis is CVJ anomaly, syringomyelia. If these things are there, that you should never miss because it is treatable condition. Okay, next one.
6 months later, the patient noticed stiffness in right lower limb while walking, had difficulty standing up from squatting position, in climbing up and down the stairs, and difficulty to negotiate foot into the chappals. He, however, could grip the chappal and feel the chappal. History of tripping and falling is also present.
So he has developed a stiffness in the lower limb that indicates upper motor neuron, and he has difficulty in getting up from the squatting position due to stiffness, or did he have altered semiology, which we always discuss? Was the difficulty due to stiffness of the leg, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Stiffness, because of stiffness, ma'am.
So then it is only upper motor neuron. If the lower motor, we have told that hip up sign, tripod sign, Gower sign, all those will happen if the muscles are weak in the lower limb. If it is stiff, of course, you will not be able to squat, you will not be able to climb due to the stiffness. And upper motor neuron type of chappal problem, he will not be able to negotiate the chappal, he will not be able to hold on and walk, and even removing. All three faces will be affected. So here he could not negotiate, but however, he could grip the chappal and feel the chappal. So sensations are all right. And negotiating was difficult. While negotiating, was the fingers overriding? If there is an upper motor neuron, the fingers will override. Negotiating is easy if it is lower motor. Negotiating is easy if it is sensory. Negotiating difficulty means it is upper motor only. And tripping and falling is present. Tripping is due to injury to the toes. Probably he has got a stiff, mild dorsiflexion weakness. So this looks like a stiffness of the upper limb on the right side, stiffness of the lower limb on the right side, with only upper motor features in the upper limb and lower limb. And bulbar features, whether they are apparently looks like lower motor, always keep in mind CVG anomaly, syringomyelia, and when you examine also, to look for all those things. Then 6 months later, similar difficulty in the left upper limb and left lower limb, and no history of thinning of limbs. Okay. So upper limbs and lower limbs looks like a Ellsberg. You see, he started in one upper limb, then went down to an upper motor neuron type of involvement of one upper limb, then the ipsilateral lower limb, opposite lower limb and opposite upper limb. All the more you should never forget Ellsberg phenomena, compressive cervical cord syndrome, where Ellsberg phenomena manifests because of ischemic involvement of the medial pyramidal fibers, that upper limb gets involved. Then due to direct effect, that side lower limb, the outerly placed upper lower limb fibers get involved. Then by Kondrakoup effect, opposite lower limb, and completion of pathology, opposite upper limb. So all these features, you should never forget. Young person, bulbar symptoms, Ellsberg-like pattern, you should not forget compressive myelopathy, and it should be investigated for CVG anomaly. Even though patient is not complaining about dissociated sensory loss or any trophic changes, we will still carefully look for all those things. That is very, very important. Next, if you say purely motor, still it is possible. Pure motor is possible in compression because pure motor fibers and proprioceptive fibers are the most vulnerable for compression, and proprioception can manifest with left mid signs or posterior column tract pain, but that need not be always there. So if it is a syrinx, the symptoms can be totally lacking and you will have to elicit that, or at least you will have to investigate all the more when there is this Ellsberg pattern is there. Next one, go. I will quickly finish today because there is some issue.
Since the past 9 months, patient and attender have noticed.
Does he have any bladder problem? No.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Patient and attender have noticed occasional twitching around the shoulders, arm, forearm, first in the right and then on the left since 5 months. Patient can.
What is that, ma'am? What do you think it is?
Fasciculations, ma'am.
Okay. Why do fasciculations happen?
Because of loss of
what does fasciculation indicate? Disconnection of the terminal axon from the nursal body. It can happen due to root involvement, it can happen due to nerve involvement, it can happen in anterior horn cell involvement. So terminal axon, which contains a group of muscle fibers, becomes disconnected from the cell body. So what happens when there is an retrograde axoplasmic flow and transmission is taking place, it goes up to the terminal axon, comes back and excites the same group of motor unit fibers. That happens. Yeah, so to know whether it is radicular, you will look for sensory features. and the distribution. If it is C5 radicular, that itching will be there only in the C5 innervated muscles. If it is nerve, only in the particular nerve innervated muscles. But if you found it in not in the nerve innervated, not in a root innervated, it is diffusely present, then you will think it is anterior onset. And total absence of sensory. So nerves or root are also produce fasciculation, even though it is relatively less common, because I am thinking of Ellsberg phenomena. I would like to rule out CVG anomaly. I will be very careful. So if fasciculations does not exclude a compressive myelopathy, in that case, I will carefully look, is it in the C5 radicular distribution? That is supraspinatus, infraspinatus, deltoid, biceps, subscapularis. Are they twitching? Are muscles which are supplied by more than one root is twitching? Are the muscles twitching diffusely? If the muscles are twitching, the fasciculation only indicate haptic conduction in the terminal axons and spontaneous activity in a motor unit due to the retrogradely transmitted information unable to reach the cell body comes back. This can happen in any injury. And looking at the distribution, you will know whether it's a nerve or a root, because in this case, it is all the more important. You should not miss a treatable case at all. And if it is found everywhere diffusely, not respecting any radicular or nerve fashion, and on examination also there is no sensory, then it will fit into anterior horn cell. So fasciculation is haptic spontaneous contraction in a motor unit due to haptic transmission in the terminal axon. Fibrillation is denervation supersensitive to single muscle fiber, which is seen only in the tongue. Rest of the body, you cannot see fibrillation. What you see is fasciculation. So this in the Ellsberg phenomena, bulbar signs, young person, you should always look for CVG anomaly, syringomyelia, syringobulbia, then only diagnose possibility of degenerative disease, which will be the last diagnosis. So you should be very careful in picking up clinical signs. Then a patient can either turn to either side of the bed and get up. Was it due to stiffness? Did he have trunk stiffness? He's unable to turn. Is it due to stiffness?
No, he was able to turn to either side of the bed. And
able to turn. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. You can get up to sit.
Back, yes. Neck pain. Okay, that is very good. You have taken about the history of back pain, neck pain, restriction of neck movement, elective. Very good. So you have elicited, you have thought about compression and you have taken all the history. So history wise, the points in favor are younger age group, bulbar features, Ellsberg pattern. So these points are favoring a compressive myelopathy. Points which are not fitting it are no bladder involvement in spite of all four limbs involvement. No sensory at all. Neck movements are not restricted. So these patient features are against a compression, but enough features are there for compression. Next one.
Next. The patient can appreciate the touch of clothes on the skin, hot and cold water while bathing. No history of difficulty in chewing, facial asymmetry, loss of sensations over the face, drooping of eyelids, blurring of vision, small smell and taste abnormalities, and neck drop. No history of memory disturbances, headache, vomiting, loss of consciousness, and conventionals. No history of fever, trauma, weight loss, decreased appetite, rash, or joint pain. No history of incoordination of movements. No history of abnormal sweating.
No autonomic features, no involuntary movement, no bladder bowel. Next.
Past history, no history of tuberculosis, diabetes, thyroid disorders, exposure to chemicals, radiation, chronic drug intake, or recent vaccination. Mm. History is born out of non-consanguineous marriage. No history of similar complaints in the family. Mm. Personal history, diet is mixed, appetite is good, sleep is adequate, bowel and bladder habits are regular, no deleterious habits.
So at the end of the history, he is a young person. He seems to have a purely motor, LMN plus UMN, involving bulbar muscles and the Ellsberg phenomena you should not miss. So even though it's purely motor, LMN and UMN, the presence of younger age group, Ellsberg phenomena, I would like to investigate the patient thoroughly for a treatable cause. And purely motor is only from the history. After examination, you might find something. I will carefully look for CVG anomaly, syringomyelia, syringobulbia, as I told, Arnold-Chiari malformations. All of them can present like this. The Ellsberg is very typical. Next possibility, if you believe that there is no sensory at all after examination also, and then of course LMN plus UMN involvement can happen with fasciculation, you will have to diagnose young onset antecedential disease. My first possibility, even the slightest clue is there, I would like to look for a treatable cause like syringomyelia, syringobulbia, CVG anomalies, Arnold Chiari malformation, for the simple reason that there's young age group, bulbar involvement, and Ellsberg pattern. What is not there is sensory is clinically not there, neck movements are normal. So next diagnosis only I will make. Ellsberg is clearly typically you told. So next possibility I will consider. After examination, maybe I will revise. But next possibility, I will think purely motor element and Yerman. Only element means you will think of muscle diseases, motor neuropathies, motor radiculopathies. But when there is element and Yerman, you are going to think of antecedential disease with fasciculation. So when there is a hemiplegic pattern, it is called as a Mills variant. So it can have a hemiplegic spread. Then you can say that after examination also sensation is not there. Then this Ellsberg term can be completed into hemiplegic variant, which became completed in a 1 year time. So started in a hemiplegic pattern that is called Mills variant. You can have a monomelic atrophy of the upper limb, monomelic atrophy of the lower limb, pier bulbar, pier pseudo bulbar, primary lateral sclerosis, all those things are there. And hemiplegic variant is a Mills variant. So you can say hemiplegic, it started as a hemiplegic variant with bulbar involvement and rapidly became bilateral. Most of these atypical variants became bilateral over a period of time. In this patient, it has become rapid. So first diagnosis, I will still keep CVJ, Arnold Chiari, syringomyelia bulbia, which I would like to rule out. Next, for imagining that nothing is there in that aspect, it will be element plus Yerman. So you are not going to think of muscle disease, motor nerve diseases, you are not going to think. Element plus Yerman combination is typical of purely motor, it is typical of antecedential disease. So I will think of Mills variant. Supposing this person is a little more younger, you have got brown violety variant where there is a brainstem atrophy and bulbar symptoms, you have got facial on type. That also you have to very carefully remember because some treatment options are there. So, but usually it happens little more younger. Female gender is more affected, males are also affected. So next differential diagnosis will be Mills variant of MND. Second, facial on or brown violety variant is there, which happens usually in the second decade. Your patient is in the third decade. But that I will remember because there is a treatment option. Those group of disorders are called riboflavinopathies. They have bulbar involvement, they have spasticity, and later they go in for facial involvement. They can they respond to high dose riboflavin therapy. Yes, he's a young person, you should always remember. So first, as I told, all the compressive disorders. Second, I will think Mills variant of MND becoming bilateral. Third, I would like to remember facial on type and the brown violety type little later manifest. Generally, it is little more younger. So later manifestation, so am I dealing with the riboflavinopathy induced motor system disease? So that I will remember because high dose riboflavin will partially at least help those patients. Then on examination, what did you find?
On general physical examination, patient was conscious, cooperative, well-oriented. BMI was 21. Neck to height ratio was normal. No pallor, itis, sinuses, clubbing lymphadenopathy or edema. Vitals, pulse was 74 beats per minute, regular rhythm, normal character, good volume, normal condition of the vessel wall, no radio-radial or radiofemoral delay, and all peripheral pulses were felt. BP was 120 by 80 in right arm supine position and 118 by 80 in right arm standing position. Respiratory rate, 18 cycles per minute, abdominal thoracic, saturation was 98% at room air, temperature 98 degrees Fahrenheit.
Go on, these are normal, no? Go ahead.
CNS examination, higher mental function. Patient was
normal. What are the abnormalities you found you tell? Flaccid dysarthria. Flaccid dysarthria of gutturals plus, was there any lingual labials? Gutturals you told. Did you find P, B, L, D, T? No?
No, ma'am. I have the audio, ma'am. Can I play, ma'am?
Okay, sure. Yes, there is some issue. I have been continuously sitting for the class from 6 o'clock. That is why. Shomu, show the audio. Did you tell them to tell Papadam, Papa, Lily, Dot? So those kind of things you tell them to speak, then you will identify.
Yes, ma'am.
It's not there?
It's there, ma'am. I'm not able to access.
Did you check Dot, Lily, Papadam, Papa? No?
But separately, we didn't check, ma'am.
Okay, then put that audio. Let me see. Otherwise, finish the presentation at the end. You present the audio.
I got it, ma'am.
Otherwise, complete the presentation, then show the audio at the end. Because the child is not well, I told no. So, and I have been sitting in the class from 6 o'clock for some other session.
Yes, ma'am. Memory was normal.
Abnormality, you tell, ma'am.
Cranial nerves, jaw jerk was exaggerated.
I want you to talk specifically about the sensations, neck head length, and then that neck height ratio, hairline, neck movements, sensations, bladder, all those things. I would like to, you first tell the positive features, then highlight on these points.
Yes, ma'am. In cranial nerve examination, jaw jerk was exaggerated, ma'am.
Yes. So some pseudobulbar component is there.
And uvula deviated to left on phonation.
Okay.
And hypoglossal nerve, tongue was atrophied, tongue muscles
were... Uvula is not very specific, ma. Palatal movement is more important. Uvula can deviate to one side. But if there is a asymmetry in the palatal arch, and palatal arch deviating to one side, that is more significant then.
And tongue was atrophied, tongue muscles were weak, and fasciculations was present, ma. Coming to motor system, patient in supine position, hip and knee extended with ankles dorsiflexed. Fasciculations were present in bilateral deltoid, brachioradialis, scapular region, trunk, and adductors of thigh.
So it is not in a radicular fashion. I told you, you should look for fasciculations. Is it respecting an R or a root pattern? It is both upper limb, lower limb. It is not in a radicular fashion. So it is diffuse. Okay, next one.
Coming to bulk, both upper limb and lower limb had equal measurements on both the sides. Okay. And the tone was increased in all the four limbs.
Okay. So definite corticospinal tract involvement, definite corticobulbar involvement as evidenced by exaggerated reflexes. Fasciculation probably seems to respect an anterior horn cell pattern. Okay. Next one.
Power, shoulder joint, all movements on both the sides were 5x5. Elbow, it was 5x5 bilateral. Wrist was 4x5 bilateral, and hand grip was weak both sides. Coming to lower limb, all the movements across hip joint, knee joint, ankle were 4x5, and EHL was also 4x5.
Okay.
Coming to reflexes, superficial reflexes, corneal reflex present bilateral, abdominal reflex absent bilateral.
Abdominal, you carefully looked on. Superficial, yes, deep abdominal. Generally, absent abdominal reflex is more common in compressive pathology, whereas degenerative pathology, usually abdominal reflex is preserved. No?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, it can be absent. I'm not saying, because I am carefully always do not want to miss a treatable condition. Generally, anterior horn cell disease, abdominal reflex will be preserved till the late. Whereas compressive cervical cord disease, abdominal reflex will be lost yearly. Okay,
yes, next one. And plantar was extensor.
Plantar can be flexor in degenerative, whereas in compression, plantar will be extensor. Supposing you found this person has got retained abdominal reflex, and plantar flexor, that is more favoring a degenerative disease. If it is absent, you have to still keep the options open and do a thorough sensory examination. Even though fasciculation is anterior horn cell pattern, I will want you to do timed vibration, fine appreciation of temperature, all those things. Okay, next one.
And Hoffman's reflex was present in bilateral.
Okay.
Deep tendon reflexes, All the reflexes in both upper limb and lower limb were exaggerated, 3+, and ankle soreness was present bilaterally. Mm. And gait was spastic gait. I have the video, ma'am. I'll show you.
Yes. Show the audio also.
This is the audio, ma'am.
It's not audible, no? You are able to hear, huh? I'm not hearing.
Didn't open, ma'am. It's opening.
Are you hearing? Then you show the gait, ma. Sound is not audible anyway.
Yes, ma'am.
So play the video.
Is it visible, ma'am?
No, I am not seeing the gait. The leg is seen, but walking is not seen. Tongue is seen, but it is not dynamic, it is static. Apparently, left leg, it is toe striking. Nothing else is seen, standing only. Oh, okay, good. Agree. If you want to tell, you have to say, instead of the heel strike which starts the gait, my patient is having toe strike.
Yes, ma'am.
And so you should always, instead of telling the spastic gait, you should say, it is toe first with the tendency to trip and drag and the paucity of movements because of the increased tone, which is very, very evident.
Yes, ma'am.
Toe first is very clear. And it is stiff, that is very clear. Upper limb movements are less, that's also very clear. But better learn that exercise of describing. In the tongue, did you see fasciculations? I am fibrillations.
Is it visible, ma'am?
No. Here only the tongue is seen, that movement is not there.
One second.
Here what we see is an atrophic tongue with fibrillation. It is symmetrical atrophy. Symmetrically atrophic. Agreed. Okay. Both sides. Audio is there? In this patient, I would definitely check linguals and labials. Linguals may be affected. Classic dysarthria of linguals and guttural strike.
Audio I'll play, ma'am.
Yes. Sensations are completely normal after examination.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Still, I would like to do the imaging and all. And if that is all excluded only, I would diagnose androcondral disease because of the combination of LMN plus UMN and very young onset, no family history, no?
No family history, ma'am.
So, very young onset, what are all the possibilities you will think? It can be a superoxide dismutase deficiency. You have got very neonatal forms, early childhood forms, adult forms, and young onset forms, always think of genetic ones. You have got so many chromosomes, 15, 20, that is there, and superoxide dismutase. Then you have got senotaxin, arsin deficiency syndromes. But always remember riboflavinopathy. For pondobulbar atrophy, they are called. MRI will show pons atrophy. And clinically, bulbar involvement with this spasticity. And they have usually little more younger, as I told. They are called brown-violety syndromes. That is pondobulbar atrophy. MRI was done. Huh? Did you show any pondine atrophy?
MRI brain was normal, ma'am.
Okay.
MRI whole spine screening done showed disc bulge at L3, L4, L4, L5, causing moderate bilateral neural foramen narrowing. And autoimmune encephalitis panel was negative, ma'am.
Okay.
SGAD and amphiphysin antibodies were negative. EMG showed active denervation in all sampled muscles. Exosaminidase levels we have sent, ma'am. That report is awaited.
Okay. Exosaminidase deficiency can present with a MND-like presentation, but in this, generally, there will be some more close visceral involvement and cognitive decline, dystonias. If those things are there, it's all the more in favor. Otherwise, I would like to think of a bulbar involvement with pseudobulbar features. That is, jaw jerk is exaggerated. That is pseudobulbar. Bulbar is tongue atrophy and palatal involvement. The spasticity can be explained by corticospinal tract involvement in the brainstem itself. So first, I would like to rule out a late presentation of a riboflavinopathy. Of course, we have difficulty in demonstrating the riboflavin transporter gene in our country. Still, you can, considering the young age, you can ask for riboflavin transporter gene deficiency, because it is at least can be arrested with a high dose of about 300 milligram of riboflavin you have to give. So that forms are also there. So young onset, purely motor syndromes. One is a Madras motor neuron disease. There you will have deafness, cardiac conduction defect, more than one family member gets involved. Then you have got the Kennedy's, that is a CAG repeat disorder. They will have gynecomastia, testicular atrophy. That you should not forget. Then the Mills variant is hemiplegic variant, I told. Then facial and is facial and bulbar muscles get involved. Limb muscles are relatively less involved. But the bulbar plus limb involvement, do not forget riboflavinopathy. If he will be able to afford, you do the riboflavin transporter gene. And if he will not afford, please give high dose of riboflavin and watch the patient. Because this is a typical picture of riboflavinopathy, except that his age group is little more later. And other genes, you know, superoxide dismutase, their diaphragm involvement is common. And ocular muscles, they can have drooping, they can have stridor. So without that also it can happen, but if there is stridor, ocular muscle involvement, which is not typical of other endovascular disease, and diaphragm onset, you can think of superoxide, but treatment does not work. Antioxidants do not work. But riboflavinopathy show good response to treatment. So even if he is unable to do, even if you are able to do nothing, kindly give him high dose of riboflavin, about 300 milligram to 1000 milligram per day you have to give. And I think you should try that. After examination, it looks like purely motor. Riluzole you can give. Edoveron, in my experience, it has not helped any patient. If it helps, no harm in trying. Riluzole only postpones the ventilatory stage. And I would like you to give riboflavin.
This brentamine we are giving, ma'am. It has coenzyme Q, magnesium and riboflavin 200 mg, ma'am.
Okay, then give more than one tablet. You give 2 TDS, high dose you give.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Other symptomatic medicine, watch and see.
Yes, ma'am.
Riboflavinopathy, I would like to rule out. Always think of treatable conditions. So I will consider first possibility. Yeah, after examination, I agree with you. It is looking like antioxidant disease because of bulbar and pseudobulbar and limb involvement. I would like to rule out riboflavinopathy.
Yes, ma'am.
Any questions, ma'am? I am sorry I went rushing because from 6 o'clock I am in class and the child in the house is not well. That is the problem. I am really sorry. Next class we will take properly. But remember riboflavinopathy in this case. And today go and read about the various manifestations of riboflavinopathy.
Yes, ma'am.
Any doubt, ma'am?
No, madam. No? No.
Any questions are there? No.
No questions.
Thank you. I am really sorry because of some situation.
Thank you, madam. No, madam.
But remember riboflavinopathy and read.
Yes.
Okay, and today also read about Ellsberg pattern, Z pattern, no? cerebral paraplegia, pseudo-syringomyelic presentation of cervical compressions, all those things you read about high cervical cord disease, read about riboflavin. You know. Okay.
Yes, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, madam.